And this is a Manhattan chapter. My name is Helen Chan, and president of Manhattan chapter. Welcome all of you. Thank you so much for coming. And now, you know, everybody, I think most of you know IFAFAS already, so I don't have to make a special introduction. IFAFAS is a PhD from Yale, and she's been teaching different schools, universities, like Harvard. And I think IFAFAS will tell you more by herself, and because she teaches really from Hong Kong, in Taiwan, in Australia, and in all kind of places. I just lost the track. And I think she knows better than anyone else. And just we give a warm welcome, and thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. Thank you for coming. It's you know, weekday night. I realize you probably prefer go home and then lie on couch and, you know, watch TV and maybe, you know, especially follow up the recent political development, you know, maybe. Maybe not. That's why you are here. And I think it's great to take a break and then, you know, try, you know, and other kinds of things. The first one, I'd like to thank also Buddha's Light International Association, Manhattan Chapter, Helen Zhang. She is the director of that chapter. And I really appreciate that she make this arrangement, and especially make this place for available. The first one I'd like to share with you why I would like to give this lecture. You probably noticed that this lecture is called Humanistic Buddhism, a lecture series. And it's not just a lecture, and maybe it's not just a Buddhism. Why I think the first one I'd like to share with you, because you probably have heard of the Zen, in Buddhism, or maybe Tibetan Buddhism, or even Pure Land. And what, or even you have heard about engaged Buddhism, social engaged Buddhism. And I believe that humanistic Buddhism is kind of, you know, still strange to your ear. Well, humanistic Buddhism, some people say it's kind of a social engaged Buddhism, because it's more, it's not retreat type of Buddhism, or only belong to the monastic, but it's more to do with our daily life, you know, our, what they call the, you know, living Buddhism. And of course, that's, you know, kind of what we understand. But of, you know, humanistic Buddhism also has its own history. The term was started from, in China. Maybe before that, I have to introduce my background. You know, I joined the order, a Buddhist order, for Guangshan, Buddha's Light Mountain. The headquarters is in Taiwan. But my teacher, Venerable Master Xing Yun, he came to Taiwan in 1949 when communists took over mainland China. So basically, nationalist party we call Kuomintang, you know, they, you know, came to Taiwan, kind of, you know, take a refuge in Taiwan. So, but the founder of Fo Guangshan's temple, Venerable Master Xing Yun, started the temple in Taiwan. So the headquarter, of course, he is in the Chan lineage, Chan, but in Chan lineage, C-H-A-N. What does the Chan mean? You can say Chan is equivalent to Zen, okay? Because it's all come from this Chinese character called Chan. And it pronounced Chan, C-H-A-N. But probably before, this is a modern, you know, Mandarin, but before, they probably call more like a Xiang. So it's close to Zen. Zen. Huh? And this word, indeed, it's developed from Diana. Diana, sorry. Diana. Hey, how come? Diana, I think. I'm sorry, Diana. I'm sorry. Funny. D-Y. Diana? Oh, how come? Okay, Diana. Okay, Diana means in Chinese translated into China. Okay, sorry, it should be Diana, I believe. Diana, I'm so sorry. It's a jet lag. Okay, Diana, it literally means meditation or concentration. Concentration. And I came to China, it was a transliteration, Diana and China. And somehow in Chinese, always drop the last the final character. I think it's because Chinese are not get used to the sound of a consonant. In Chinese, we don't have that sound. So a lot of the Buddhist terminology came to China were drop. And so from Diana, means meditation, means concentration become Chan, Chan Na. This is pronounced Chan Na. And so, Chan Na. Okay. So, anyway, when we talk about Chan in Chinese, that means also Zen in Japanese pronunciation. That means the school of meditation. So, of course, in China, the Chan school have a major five school, and the master is belong to Venerable Master Xingyi is belong to one of the school is called Linji, in Japanese it's called Linzai. However, in Japan, the Zen school went to Japan, then the most of the popular one indeed is the Sōdo-shu or the Sōdo school. So the Linzai or Linji it's become more popular, dominate in China, and then the Sōdo-shu or the Sōdo or the Caodong it's become popular. But they are all belong to the Chan and belong to so-called Zen school. So for Guangshan, Venerable Master Xingyun, from the lineage, he is the 48th generation of the Chan school. And so we will be the what we call the 49th generation. Well, you probably say, well, of course you probably know, especially in the West, you know, if you take out the meditation, there was almost no Buddhism at all. And lots of people think the Buddhism is kind of equivalent to meditation. Or Buddhism is just meditation. Huh? So even lineage, the Master Xingyi is belong to Zen school. However, the Buddhism he advocated is called humanistic Buddhism. Of course, that's the what we call the English translation. English translation. Okay, humanistic Buddhism. Humanistic Buddhism. It's a translator from Chinese character called Ren Jian Fo Jiao. Okay, Ren Jian literally means that this means a people. Human realm Buddhism. It's the Buddhism for the human realm. What does it mean? Okay. Well, it has it's a philosophical meaning, but it also has a historical, you know, development as well. The first one, let's talk about the meaning. Why Buddhism is for the human realm, or you know, kind of for humanity or later, huh? Especially, you know, in the time of the Master Xing Yun, the time he growing up, and 1927, he was born in mainland China, and to the time he moved to Taiwan during that time. The Buddhism in China at that time, I will go the detail, but at that time Buddhism, many people think, well, you know, what about when you think of monks and nuns, where are you going to find them? A lot of students came to Fort Guangshan. Every year I have 50 students came to Fort Guangshan, and I'm so glad I have two here. Michael and Nicole are here. When I bring the student to Fort Guangshan, the first one, they were kind of shocked because they were shocked to see, you know, the Fort Guangshan temple like a forbidden city, because they are looking for more like in forest. I remember the first year, one of the students said to me, "Say, oh, I came to the monastery life program, a wooden fish program. I'm looking for enlightened monks and nuns wandering in the forest." But, you know, I mean, on the contrary, I find like all the monks, you know, like thousands, maybe they are still unenlightened, we don't know. But they were so busy. So that image was so different. Well, I mean, exactly the people were thinking that if you want to find monks and nuns, where you should find? In the forest. Yes, but that's true, because in later, around like, you know, especially 18th, 19th century, of, you know, 20th century, most of the monks and nuns are retreat back from the metropolitan area. It's very different from when the Buddhism came to China. The first, you know, like 800, or even longer, especially when Buddhism came from India to China, most of the monks and nuns were in the metropolitan area. You can tell from a book called Luoyang Qielan Ji, the monastery and temple in Luoyang, the capital. Then you can you know, that book, it testify that the Buddhism came to China were in the urban area, but later the development, the monks and nuns are all, you know, kind of in a remote place. So people think at that time, people were thinking that the Buddhism should be, what I mean, it's not in the West. I will talk about the later in the West. But at that time in China, people think the monk, you should find the monks and nuns in the forest, not supposed to be in Chang'an or in Luoyang, or not supposed to be in New York City, supposed to be upstate New York somewhere. And they also think that, well, Buddhism is to be focused on next life, because when we talk about reincarnation, and especially contract with the Zen practice, they also have a school called Pure Land. Pure Land. And this Pure Land practice, it's for people like, you know, you chanting Amitabha's name, and then you will be reborn in Amitabha's, you know, a paradise. And that's the idea. So a lot of things focus on next life, you know, the place after life, and also depend on Amitabha. At that time, Amitabha for them is looks like a god, a savior. Okay, now in philosophical, what it means, humanistic Buddhism. Because under this kind of, you know, Buddhist condition, a new movement is called humanistic Buddhism, develop. What does it mean about humanistic Buddhism? The first one, Buddhism is for the people on this earth and for this life, and also focus on human being, not for the deity. The first one, the Buddha was born, was a historical figure. Okay, how many people, most people know what's the Buddha mean, though. Buddha. We call the founder of Buddhism, name is Buddha or Sakyamuni Buddha. Buddha means what? Awakened. Awakened. Okay, awakened. Buddha never means a god or you know, a deity. It's a historical, you know, historical human being. But he just the one who attained the enlightenment. Well, I'm not going through the, you know, the biography, the life story of the Buddha. I think that if you are interested, you can come to me. Maybe I can introduce you some book to read. But the Buddha, the you know, is Sakyamuni Buddha. Okay. Okay, Sakyamuni Buddha. He was a historical figure. He was born in India. And he attained the enlightenment in India. He practiced. He didn't attain the enlightenment in heaven, but he was attained the, you know, enlightenment in this human realm. So he make the enlightenment possible. That's why we talk about this humanistic Buddhism is you can accomplish, you know, in this world. And most important is, as I mentioned, like, you know, during that time, most people were thinking, okay, chanting Amitabha, I'd like to accumulate all the merit. So in the next life, I will, you know, be reborn in the heaven, but or go to the pure land of Amitabha. However, humanistic Buddhism, according to Yogacara, that means the Buddhist psychology, the theory, okay, it's our mind create this world. What does it mean, create? It's our mind perceive this world. For example, you know, the same in living in New York. Some people say, oh, I love New York, for young people, especially for young people. But for some people, it's crazy. Okay, so the same world, why the, your perception and my perception are different? So from Buddhist's, you know, Yogacara's view, you know, it's because your mind, your own experience, create the world you experience. Okay, we will talk about that, you know, that more. So according to this Yogacara view about the mind, the manifestation of mind, that you can make this world like a pure land. So you can build a pure land on this land, this in this world. You don't have to wait until, you know, the afterlife. So, you know, the place in humanistic Buddhism, we call this place. And then this time and this person. So, 此时此地此人 in Chinese. Focus on this place. You can build the pure land on this, or what we call the heaven, okay, or paradise, on this earth. And then in this life. And you also can make you happy at this moment, as long as you live this present moment. And so, you know, that's a, you know, you through the meditation can help you to focus, and also to help you to the way, you know, the Buddhist teaching non-self, and then if you look at what that means about interdependent origination, and if you understand those major philosophy in Buddhism, then you can change, transform the way you look at things. We call zhuan nian. Then you realize that, or you know, at the moment, like, you know, there were so many things in your mind, you know, anxiety, you know, distraction. But at the time, you just focus on meditation or breathing. You empty your mind and focus on the moment of just breathing. And that moment is kind of experience of enlightenment. So this is also one of the focus in Japan, the Dogen, you know, Sodo. He said, 直观打坐, you know, only sitting. Well, he said, sitting, it's the moment you, when you sit there, it's attain the enlightenment. It means at that moment, it's if you focus at that present moment. So, I mean, this all make it possible. And this person, as I mentioned, that in humanist Buddhism, is a focus on you, or just me, okay, this person. You don't want to depend on God. You are not created by God. And then, you know, your future, your destination are not, you know, controlled by the God either. And, but also, this person, also in the sense like, we have to emphasize on human responsibility as well. 此人, as I mentioned, that you know the Buddha was born in this world, especially practice in this world, and attain the enlightenment in this world. So, from the humanistic Buddhism, focus on this one. And you might be wondering, well, is that like a new kind of Buddhism? I don't think it's a new, even though it's a kind of a new movement in Buddhism, but it's not new kind of Buddhism because the teaching, the concept, the philosophy, it's all in the what we call the fundamental teaching of Buddhism, of the Buddhism. So this is a humanist Buddhism. Okay. So what I'm going to do with our course is every lecture I pick up a topic. I think that I would like to Helen,
yes.
Could you have a we have a handout? Maybe you I'm not sure that you pick it up. Okay. Well, today I prepare two handouts for you, three. The first one is the course outline, kind of the theme. We're going to talk about it for these, indeed, it's 8 weeks. Okay. Today, open house, it's not really a formal course yet, but. Okay, and then later I have a second one. Second one is the handout on meditation. Before the end of the program, I'd like to demonstrate how to do the meditation. Maybe a lot of you already know how to do the meditation, but meditation is just like three meals. You know, you have to do it every day. You won't find it's too much. Okay. And then also the third one will be kind of a very simple handout for next week, okay? Okay, so if you look at the handout, from next week, I pick up the 8 topics. And focus on these 8 topics, and we can talk about it, how the Buddhist view on this topic. And I will focus on each lecture, I focus on some of the major concept in Buddhism. And I also will show, as I mentioned, in my course description, I mentioned that I will refer to the primary sources, that means the sutra, the Buddhist scripture, but also at the same time, I like to find some of the article. Hopefully we can find from, for example, like a New York Times or the other magazine, and we can talk about kind of current issue and relate to this subject. Okay, so for example, religion and faith. Recently, I heard a lot about, especially from radio, I heard. Called religion and politics. Now it's also a hot topic since the presidential election is right now, on the way. So what does it mean about religion, and what does it mean about faith? And then do we need a religion at all? You know, I would like to show you from the Buddhist view. For example, the quotation is called Kalama Sutra. Because most of, we always get the idea, like for most of the religion always ask you, okay, you have to base on belief. If God tell you or whatever in the Bible and in scripture, you are supposed to believe. But that's not true from Buddhism, from especially from this sutra. And I will try to, either you can find online or we can bring some copy. Because it's kind of a, after you register, please leave your email. And then every week I can send you, through the email, I can send you the attachment with the material, you can read it. In this sutra, very interesting. The Buddha basically, people ask him, he said, how do we know, so many religious people, if you know that during the time of the Buddha, they were so-called officially have 60 schools, non-Buddhist school called 外道, 62外道, they have a different view. So everybody come to tell the, okay, my teaching is the superior. Okay, and that one is come to say, my teaching is superior. So the village people were so confused, say, which one we should believe? Okay, so very interesting in this sutra, he provided some criteria. And very interesting also this sutra, the Buddhas, when the people ask the Buddha, say, well, how should we, set up this criteria? How should we believe them? The Buddha just basically say, don't believe it because, your good friend tell you, or because everybody says so. Or don't believe it even because your teacher tell you. Well, I think this is a very challenge, And especially come from a religious a perspective, he say, don't just believe it because your teacher tell you. You need to have a certain criteria and to make a judgment yourself. So that would be from this sutra. Of course, I'm also would like to share with you that, for example, on religion, came to the West. Because basically this is the culture dominated by what we call the apprehend religion, start from Judaism and Islam and Christianity. And these are three major religion basically, start from so-called the creator God. And also the religion, the world of a religion is something to do with, your commitment with God, religion, if you look from Latin, the character. But very interesting, in Chinese, we translate the 宗教, literally 宗教. I think maybe Chinese didn't have that word as a so-called religion, but it's a fine, some kind of correspondent. But in Chinese, they are not necessary to do with God at all, the 宗教. Zong. And indeed, the Zong and Jiao, this Zong Jiao, together means a religion. It's nothing to do with God at all. Zong means what? Discipline yourself, especially come from the founder. One of the founder of a humanistic, pioneer of a humanistic Buddhism in China, Tai Xu. And what does the Jiao mean? It's to educate the other people. So from his view, a religion is, what kind is a religion? It's not like your commitment, your covenant with the God. But it's what is a religion? It's you discipline yourself, purify yourself. And then you educate other people. That is the religion. And I find that it's very interesting. Huh? So, and also in this one, I would like to introduce, a very kind of popular belief in the concept in all the other Chinese religion called heaven, tian. is a Tian is a creator, or Tian like in the Confucianism or in Taoism. I probably want to bring it because since this is, you know, my background is Chinese Buddhism, and the Buddhism also Chinese Buddhism is not just a pure Indian Buddhism, but also from, you know, influenced by Indian and Taoism. So I would like to bring that. So, well, I mean, here I talk about three refuge. Huh. In Buddhism, we also talk about refuge. Refuge in Buddha, refuge in the Dharma, refuge in the Sangha. Is that means that you have to believe the Buddha like a god, or you have to believe in Bible, you know, by with what Bible was saying. So I would like to give the interpretation of what does mean the three refuge. I'm not going to for detail because otherwise you won't come next week. Okay, we leave it for that for next week. Okay, so the second week I would like to talk about the topic on war and peace. I think right now it's very important. Okay, and especially with this city. I know the last week I couldn't make it, but last week we just have a 7 years anniversary of, you know, in memory of September 11, the incident. And I remember right after the 7/11 happened, I wrote a book called Safeguarding the Heart, and later the second print is called Tender Heart. And what happened was, I feel at that time they only have a voice on, you know, from a Christian or from the Judaism or Islam or Muslim voice. I find like lack of the voice from a Buddhism, and people tend to think that Buddhism is very, you know, passive. So at that time I just decided to write a book, you know, The Tender Heart there. And basically that's a discuss about you know, for example, what does it mean about good and evil? Remember after the September 11, George Bush basically like point out people say, those evil. But he forgot he has three fingers pointing himself. Okay, so what is the good and evil mean? Okay, and then, we are talking about, the, you know, justice. And we have to think about, what does it mean by justice? Oh, it's more like a punishment. You know, we have to be honest. It's a punishment, or really what we're looking for, the justice. And very interesting, after September 11 happened, you know, if you read some of the, you know, Americans' foreign policy, you know that we have done a lot of, we make a mistake, you know, in the foreign policy. You know, Saddam Hussein was an American airline, you know, and maybe include the Bin Laden. I'm not trying to criticize, you know, I try to keep it neutral, but I try to present the factor. You know, especially from, as a religious people, we try to kind of look at it, you know, from another, what we call the transcendental, you know, view to look at it. Maybe sometimes my voice sounds, you know, sarcastic, but we try to see, you know, from the other view, from the other, especially spiritual view. So I will talk about, you know, good and evil and justice and punishment. So that was all the things in I discussed in my the book. You know what? You know, sometimes I listen to the NPR, you know, I like to listen to the radio because, I can continue to work. And, but, you know, very interesting. You find like during the daytime, and most of the NPR were, you know, kind of made, they create a program in United States. And midnight is from BBC, huh? And during the daytime, there was a program, the broadcaster not broadcaster, you know, made in United States, always focused. This year is always focused on Iraq, mostly, majorly. But the BBC, it's the other, like from the British, you know, it's the other side. They even talk about, they talk about more on China. They talk about Shanghai, you know, the economy of Shanghai. I find it's more interest, more global view. More global view. This is what, every summer I always went to China, and I see the development of China. And I travel a lot. I travel from January to April, 4 months. Do you know how many boarding passes I have? 25. That means that I don't know. So that's my life. So the reason I give this I like to give the lecture series here because I force myself to stay in one place more than 10 weeks. That's also one of the reason. Yeah. But it helped me to see what's going on. You know, we always talk about the globalization, but you really have to go to see it. And you feel what does it mean about like a global village? And frankly, being, I'm also American citizen, huh? And when I went to China, I see the development there, huh? I saw the terminal in Beijing, the third terminal, Terminal 3 in Beijing, the called Capital Beijing Airport. It was astounding because it's the biggest airport I ever seen. Like when you get there, you see the miles and miles. It's just one terminal. And then you check in, it's all open up space, and then you sit on the third floor. After you check in, you sit on the third floor waiting for your plane, waiting for boarding, and you basically can see from the third floor to the second to the basement. It all looks transparent. And of course, you know, from this Beijing Olympic, you have seen, you know, the bird's net, the water cube, and also the National Art Performance Center. It's the world-class architecture, all in Beijing. You know, and I'm just worried about the, you know, it seems now we are all in United States, I can say that, but I cannot say that in China, okay. in the Olympic, during the Olympic game, I always check with the people, which country you wish to win, I know, gold medal. And I asked people, Chinese people, they immigrate to United States. Very interesting. More than 10 years, immigrate to America more than 10 years. I asked them, I said, which one, Chinese or America? And let me tell you, you probably feel very proud. So far, everyone say America. We like to see America, you know, get gold medal. I mean, I was born in Taiwan, and then all the cultural, geography, history, I studied Chinese and the master from mainland China. So, you know, I was told I'm Chinese, but, you know, before 10 years ago, before I was okay, I shouldn't let you know my age, but unfortunately, before I was 40 years old, I never been to China, am I right? But I was told I'm Chinese. And then, so when I went to United Nations in Bangkok, and one lady looked at my name, Eva, he said, your name is Eva. Can I ask you, are you Chinese or are you Taiwanese? Of course, this question is very, very sensitive in Taiwan. Okay, and I also don't know that lady is from mainland China or from Taiwan. it's a blue or it's a green, green party or blue party. So I say, well, I was born in Taiwan. My master from mainland China, and I study a lot of Chinese culture and history, but I haven't been in China yet at that time. And I say, but I'm American citizen. I think that's the most important. I said, but I'm American citizen, but I'm a global citizen. Oh. So I think that come back to the point I want to make is, I really like to see that, you know, American open up. You know, we cannot have a closed mind to think, okay, America always the number one. And of course, I hate to see just one country, just America or just Chinese, become so-called the only one superpower. I think it would be disaster for the humankind. we need to see that more, you know, kind of so-called the superpower, you know, nations pro, you know, to kind of keep a balance. You know, this is what I you know, we should, you know, to see. And the reason I talk about war and peace here is I think that we are here in America should look at it, what does war mean? You know, we got incurred in the Iraq war for so many years. You know, we have to see the other thing. So I'm not trying to make you feel bad, but, you know, I try to point out, you know, the other perspective. Okay, then, you know, the 3 weeks, I like to focus on so-called Mayan life. And, well, maybe you have heard about an institution called Mayan Life Institution. Huh? And that started basically, you know, focus on Buddhism and what we call neuroscience, the science of mind. They have done a lot of the conferences, and this is also become a trend. And now we study Buddhism. A lot of people study Buddhism, study from this kind of psychology, Buddhist psychology, and make it very scientific, and not much to do with Buddhism, to do with a religion. So lots of people think that, okay, I still can do meditation, I still can figure out, you know, my brain, I don't have to become a Buddhist, okay? And that's fine, you know, that is fine. But I just say this, you know, yes, indeed the Buddhism have a great portion, talk about a mind, or what you may talk about, it's a Buddhist psychology or Buddhist phenomenology, you know? And well, the Buddhist the practice is not put your effort, believe in God, but to realize the nature of your own mind and then learn how to control and discipline or even transform your perspective about this world. And that's talked about in a lot on the Lokacara. So I will spend time to talk about that. And the fifth the week, living and dying. This is even more interesting because of death. It's a kind of become a taboo. We never talk about death. And then some people just believe, you know, after we die, then we were reborn in the heaven. Or some people just totally, you know, don't believe in reincarnation. You know, just say, okay, you know. I mean, I have a good friend. He is a New York federal judge, but he right now it's 85 years old now. Huh? A good friend of mine, dear friend, and I always try to kind of comfort you. Say, hey, you know, I say, Mark, you are a great person. I think that, you know, next life you come back, we can become a good friend again. Huh? And he said, no, I don't believe it. I believe it when I die, I become ash, you know. So, of course, I mean, the other thing is very interesting also. You know, I myself engage with a lot of interface dialogue. So, interesting, in my consciousness, I mean, the reincarnation is so natural. I never doubt about it. But because my background, I never grew up in any kinds of this apprehend religion at all. I'm not Christian, so I never believed that there was a creator God. Okay, it's just not in my consciousness. So there was one time, you know, I have the interface dialogue, and I have a good friend. His name is Meg Funk, and she is a Catholic nun. We are really good friends, you know, like more like sisters. We share a lot of things. Very funny, when we get together, you know, I also co-organize a meeting, a conference called Nuns in the West. So we always have a Catholic nun and then Buddhist nun together, and we share. And very interesting, when we all together, when we come out, we forgot, oh, you are Christian, I'm a Buddhist. We never like aware about, okay, I'm a Buddhist and you're a Christian. But at that time, sometimes we feel like we are all women, huh? A group of women together to share. Or sometimes you find it's all human nature. But anyway, I'd like to share with you this this dialogue. There was one time in elevator, finally only me and Meg. And I said, Meg, you are so intelligent. How can you believe in God? And then she then turned to me and said, Eva, you are so smart too. How can you believe in reincarnation? And that was the first time, I got a shock. I said, I got to think about reincarnation. So, and for this section I will share with you, especially in from the Buddhist Sutra, Yogacara Bhumi, it talks a lot about the procedure of, the process of dying. Very clear and very interesting is, it almost very, it makes sense, very logical, but still, I would like to tell you that I'm not going to force you to believe, okay? I leave that to you after I explain you the text, and you yourself to decide whether you believe in reincarnation or not. It's not from me. So that would be the karma and reincarnation. Okay, now come to the topic of money and economy. Wow, I think it's about, especially maybe we should talk about that this week, but yeah, I know the money, and lots of people feel in emptiness too. Okay, of course the emptiness is different, of course Buddhism's concept of emptiness, it's not nothingness, Well, it's really, bad news from Wall Street. But however though, I'm just going to share with you kind of in general information and the concept, because I myself, all my friends try to explain the finance, the stock market. Ben tried many times, almost 10 times, he's a financial expert. And I always get lost at the beginning of, 5 minutes. I never get, continue. Couldn't understand what's about, a stock market is. But I would still like to, share with you that how Buddhists view about so-called fortune and money. And I find very interesting, the reason I use the Heart Sutra, because I just find that in the Heart Sutra there was a saying about, the form is emptiness. The emptiness is form. Form means a kind of material. And recently I just have an experience, because I went to Beijing, and I stayed with a lady. She is the antique collection, a collector. And sometimes she said to me, she said, if I give you a piece of antique, for your this life, don't have to worry about it. And I, of course, my reaction is, of course, I don't need your antique, because I have to depend on you all my whole life. If you don't, right now you like me, you like to give me antique. How about if you don't like me, you take it back? So that's in my, so I stay in her apartment. For her, each piece is kind of worth, $1 million. But very interesting, when I sit in there, I watch a vase, and I don't know what is the value. And I don't even know it's the real one, or the, what are called the forged one. And for me, when we talk about priceless, for her it's priceless, and for me also priceless. And so I find very interesting about these value and money things. It's the same thing, but because our perspective are different. Oh, I also very in my life I don't have a hero, but one of my heroes is Warren Buffett. You probably don't believe it. And I know, now I see Michael is laughing at me. Well, he has a lot of money. But what kind of life he live? I think he said he still live in a half a million the house, not like a Bill Gates. But I like the way he still live in a very simple life. I think that's the way interesting to see that, the person, he view about what he call, what we call the money, you know. So I like to kind of share with you on that too. Okay, and then the other one is a social identity. Okay, social identity. Well, especially I pick up this one. I was going to write a book on this one, you know, because what is about social identity means, well, Obama have to try very hard to you know, become the president because he's a black, and he's not black enough, or he's not white enough. And then we also have a women's issue. You know, these are all the social identity. And but from Buddhist view, you know, from very interesting from Buddhist view, especially in the Diamond Sutra, really, I mean, the everything, can we look at things, you know, beyond the form or the appearance? This is the to train us. I find, you know, sometimes, I mean, after you kind of understand or you practice the Buddhist value, and then you just see the people got stuck into this so-called social identity, like, okay, I'm a man, you are women, I'm white, you are black. It's just, you know, kind of unbelievable, you know, so much the discrimination. I think that I was the conference in Japan, and you know, we have a kind of debate, and one of the person, I mean, of course, I mean, we shouldn't take it out of the context, but basically, you would say, basically, there was a message, you know, message you say, well, I mean, even though, you know, he has you know, Harvard Law School and everything, and then, but why he can become, you know, the president. And I think at that time I was joking about it, you know, I make a statement, I say, oh, then maybe Obama should, if we have to make a judgment about, you know, the white and black, maybe Obama should bleach like into white, like Michael Jackson, yeah. So I think that this, if you can, you take out the color and think about it, you know, and why we got stuck to those, you know, appearance. Very interesting. So this is, I try to from, well, here I should maybe mention about Diamond Sutra, the non-self. Okay, environmental issue. Okay, I think that, well, I, you know, this book is about September 11, and I wrote this book about junk. Original is called Junk. And this book originally called Suffering. But my publisher, they decided to put my face on the book. And I just protest to them. I said, hey, Martin, look at it. This is face to do with the suffering, and this is this book to do with the junk. Okay, so they have to change, okay. Well, anyway, you know, in this book, original I mentioned, it's going to talk about junk, but I know I, from this, well, I talk about material junk, food, and then I also talk about stuff. We have lots of junk stuff, and then we also have lots of junk communication, like a spam, the email, and you know. And then from this is kind of, we also have lots of junk relationship. If you hang out with someone for the whole day, and finally you come home, you feel so sad and more, you know, depressed. That means you do not have a very healthy relationship. Okay, and then at the end, we not just have a material junk, but we also have a spiritual junk. So it's emotion and thought. Okay, so and of course I will talk about the from a Buddhist interdependent origination, you know, the global warming and all the other issue, it's all the, you know, the Buddhist major teaching, the interdependent origination. Okay, humanity. Buddhism have the, you know, the main teaching on the bodhisattva vow. What does it mean about bodhisattva? Bodhisattva literally means, bodhi means enlightenment, like the Buddha, the same root. And sattva means a being, you know, kind of a being on the path toward enlightenment. Or the beings, sentient beings, who vow to enlighten other people. So from Buddhist view, that if you are just by yourself, it's basically no meaning at all. The meaning of a life is to depend on how much you can benefit other people. And I find that very interesting, because when I was 13 years old, I started looking for, like, what is the meaning of life? I recently just have a reunion with my high school friends, you know. And now she become a lawyer and a rich woman. She doesn't have to do anything. And he told me every year has $1 million, you know, dollars came in. But she said to me, she said, when we were in the junior high school, you say, you are so weird. I said, I'm so weird. I said, how come? I said, well, every time when we have a party, you know, we were talking about a movie and good food and even, you know, boyfriend. And then you just walk in, and then it's a time for you to ask questions. And then you just suddenly say, what is the purpose of life? It's a 很煞风景, huh? I say, you just kill the atmosphere, basically. So they already look at me and say, you are weird. So if you know, later you become a nun, we never surprise. You know? So the meaning of life, it has been kind of, I've been, you know, questioning, you know, since I was 13 years old. And I really found it, you know, the answer in Buddhism. I find like the meaning of life, it's based on how much you can do for other people. You know, and also how much that you know, I always say how big is your heart will be the how big is your world. If you just kind of everything focus me, I myself, then your world just one person. But if your mind just for one family, okay, my husband, my wife, my children, and then your heart, your world just for that family. But your heart is for the all sentient being, all human being, sentient being, then that's also your world as well. And of course, I mean, at the end about this one, or interdependent origination, that the Buddhist, the sutra, we call Garland Sutra, Avantasaka Sutra, you know, later I will introduce that. He has the idea about called intranet. And very interesting, intranet. Hey, it looks like an internet. Huh. And then in this idea of an intranet, it means, intro means one of the heaven, the deity's name. But basically the intranet means the world, like, if you imagine like a spider net, okay, the web, the spider web, you know, all connected together, but like, the web. But on each knot, there was a pearl, three dimension, okay, on the each knot. And then each of the pearl mutual reflect. It's the pearl like a mirror, so bright, so you can mutual reflect, have a mutual reflection. So that means that the image on this pearl will be reflect on this one, and this one, on this one, and infinity. So the message from this sutra, Avantasaka or Garland Sutra, is try to show that our universe is just like an intranet, and we are infinite, penetrated to each other, you know, affect each other, and it's the mutual reflection. And especially you talk about individual, like yourself, it's the reflection of your environment. So I can see from yourself, your family education, your friendship, your thought, you know, were influenced by current philosophy or ideology as well. We cannot live alone. We always live interdependently. Okay. Okay, so that will be basically, you know, the of course, I mean, the suffering consciousness, you know, karma and consciousness. The first one, I'd like to introduce you this book, The Co-Teaching, written by Venerable Master Xingyun. And then the content inside here, you have the dependent origination, Four Noble Truths, karma, the three Dharma seal, emptiness, mind, nature, nirvana, take a refuge in triple gem, taking five precepts, follow the Four Noble Truths, become a bodhisattva. So basically this book is the core teaching, the fundamental. So, you know, most of the include here. And of course, I mean, when you come to that subject, we're not just limited to this you know, concept of the Buddhist fundamental concept. And of course, Humanist Buddhism, this book also, you know, the master writing a blueprint for life. So in this book also have a kind of a discussion on the different topic from what it calls a Humanistic Buddhism viewpoint. And for example, I make 20 copies. Hand out here, you can take home. This one is on religion, from Buddhist view, from humanist Buddhist view on religion. So it's kind of prepared for next week. And of course, you also got this handout. Every lecture, at the beginning of lecture, I hope it come on time. I almost late, you know, today, but. I hope you come on time. We start from 6 o'clock. You come in and sit in meditation, and every day I would like to give you some tip on how to do the meditation on the technical. And today, you know, I give you the handout here. It's later we like to spend some minutes, and this is a very basic, you know, on the meditation. Okay, so this is the tip for meditation for today. Okay, so that will be what we're going to do. Start next week. You should come. You know, I hope you can come on time by 6 o'clock, and we'll sit for 20 minutes. But maybe during the meditation or at the end of the meditation, I will kind of give some technician or the instruction, or we can Q&A on meditation as well. And then start from 6:30, we will start the topic, you know. And I do have two tiny book here. This is for free. So it's called a Fundamental Concept of Humanistic Buddhism and the Essence of a Chan. So these are all written by the master. So feel free to pick up so you can read it. But for those books, since they are all come out from a publisher, so you just, you know, kind of a purchase from Helen. Okay. And the other one I maybe like to introduce you will be Jeff Thompson. Jeff, it's a basically he's helped me to help this program to do the recruitment, and also I think more like a management. And you are Helen is the director, and Jeff is the manager. So if you have anything, you also can contact Jeff as well. On this hand now, you know, you can see with three email address here. You know, before we end of the, you know, today's introduction, and before we go to meditation, I'd really like to have a clock here, so I will know what time.
Control.
Where? Oh, okay. Oh, okay, okay, good. I think we are on the, you know, good timing. Okay, I'd like to share with the history, kind of history of humanistic Buddhism, huh? Very interesting. Of course, this term was maybe started from the pioneer, like a Tai Shi, in China. Okay, and then well, 1911 was when Sun Yat-sen kind of established, called he, you know, kind of. turn over the Qing dynasty, and then overturn the Qing dynasty, and then established called a Republic of China, okay, ROC. But at that time, the China was still in like a turmoil, a lot of warlord. Everybody still, you know, after the kind of what we call either the monarchy, the imperialism, everybody still want to become the emperor. And it's so hard to understand. You want to become a Republican or a country or become a president. So Sun Yat-sen basically was forced to resign, but, you know, take over by those, you know, warlords. So in China at that time was always have a civil war. Of a civil war, and of course you also have the war fighting with Japan. If you remember that during the second, you know, the World War II, the second world war, and so during that time, that China has a, you know, outside have an invasion, and inside you have the civil war. So you can imagine that even before that, the Qing Dynasty, you have the eight country, Western country, and come to invade China. And then at that time, Chinese have to sign a lot of unfair treaty. So, and China also at that time kind of was amazed by the, you know, Western science and democracy, technology. But also at the same time invaded by the so-called foreigner. So so inside the country at that time in China, especially the people like Sun Yat-sen, at that time they had the mind like, how can we call a self, you know, strengthen a movement? That means how can we make the country strong? Okay. So during that time, a lot of Buddhist monk living in that condition, and they realized that, okay, we cannot have a Buddhism kind of a retreat back in the forest. And also, since there was a reform of education at that time in China, so many of the Buddhist monasteries were took over by the government. So the Buddhist monasteries kind of lose their property. And then, but you also see, you know, I mean, the influence, impact by Western democracy, freedom, and the science. So not only the country would like to have a, you know, like a movement, but include inside the China itself, in Buddhism itself. So at that time, contract to so-called the Buddhism only deal with afterlife. Then a bunch of the monk led by so-called the Tai Shi. Okay, Tai Shi, he's a monk. He just would like to start it, you know, kind of have the movement. So he emphasized, you know, this led by him, but also, you know, a bunch of the monks. You will find a lot of writing on the magazine, Buddhist magazine at that time. And they would talk about, say, okay, Buddhism cannot be, you know, hiding in the forest, but we need to have a social engaged. So that is the origin of a so-called humanistic Buddhism. Okay, so until then, it's almost, but Tai Shi didn't, you know, even though he has a theory, but nothing really happened. No action, his idea never really carry out. I think it's because that condition in China. So a lot of monks and nuns, mostly monks, I believe, include Master Xing Yun, came to Taiwan in 1949. And then they were in Taiwan and started, you know, kind of a reformed Buddhism and engage, social engaged. And if you look at, of course, if you study the very modern history of Buddhism in Taiwan, you have the Venerable Master Xingyun for Guangshan. You also have Ciji, what they call the, you know, compassion, great compassion, relief. And also have a Huagu, the Dharma drum by Venerable Master Sheng Yan. Or, you know, the movement, the new movement in China, in Taiwan. So here it's a, if you look at humanistic Buddhism, here is the development, the humanistic Buddhism a movement in China, and then Taiwan. But in Taiwan, there was no foreign invasion. It basically modernized, okay. So it's the humanistic Buddhism basically, it's in Taiwan, it's called modernization. The Buddhist modernization. Very interesting here though, now it's 2008. This is also the reason I would like to have this lecture here. When humanistic Buddhism came to the West, it's different, the condition is different in China. We are not in China. We are not in Taiwan either. So what does it mean about humanistic Buddhism in the West? This is something I want to figure it out. I think it's a good philosophy and very practical. And also it's a really can trace back to you know, the time of the Buddha. So like a Venerable Master Xingyun always said, well, you know, the teaching of a Buddha is a humanistic Buddhism. The Buddhism taught by the Sakyamuni Buddha is a humanistic Buddhism because he focused on human being. He talked to the human being. He was focused on this earth. Huh? Well, I think that in the West, I would believe that humanistic Buddhism is kind of Buddhism for humanity. A lot of time, people ask me. I mean, I'm very fortunate. I was educated in Taiwan, but I also came to United States. So I have the kind of both Western and Eastern education. And I, you know, sometimes you know people will say, I will say, okay, in Asia we do this. This is you know kind of what we call the Asia or Eastern value. And then now come here, we go, oh, this is Western value. And which one is better? And I realize both have advantage and disadvantage. The best one is as long as the value for humanity. Really, we should focus on, you know, the human being. It's not because it's West. It's not because it's East. It's not because it's Islam or because it's a Christian or it's Buddhist. We are all human beings. Huh. So I think that humanistic Buddhism is the Buddhism for humanity. And I think that came to the West, we're talking about more on the global value, humanity, you know. So this is something I would like to learn from you as well. What does mean about humanistic Buddhism? And I find very interesting that humanist Buddhism at the first 50 years is so-called the, you know, kind of a Chinese humanist Buddhism. The second part is kind of the second for the, you know, in Taiwan. And now it's the third part. And very interesting, it's a 50 years. Of course, I mean, after 50 years, humanist Buddhism in the West, I don't know. I'm not sure I can see it. But, you know, anyway, so that would be my, the idea for this lecture, for this workshop. And anyone has a comment? Oh, you know, also the other one is you can also email me if you have something you think you might be more interested in, maybe something more appropriated, you know, the topic, and you'd like to share comments. Any comments? Today it's kind of everyone's shy, but the next week I would like to have a Q&A. Huh? Every time after I give a talk, we like to have a Q&A, just sharing. Yeah. And if you can bring some article, like something from news, from you know, to share to do with the topic, would be even great, you know, greater as well. Yeah. So anyone has a comment? about these courses. Do you think it's a kind of good idea? You like the theme at all? Even though not every theme, but most of them or some of them. Okay. Yes, Helen.
I think we have a quick site designed by Jeff, and there's all kind of information. It's a very, very, very good information source.
Oh.
I think Jeff will.
Jeff, would you like to write down the website? Yes, yes. Jeff help a lot.
You can write Jeff. Technically, old Jeff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And he even set up a blog.
Yeah,
am I right?
That's what I'm saying.
Oh, okay.
So you can write your comments there and what you like to. We will always check. If I didn't have time, we will look and then we will pass the information. For example, you can go home tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Or what do you like, what you don't like, we can discuss.
And then also the you know, the useful information we can put on this one too. I will give it to Jeff. I'm a IT idiot. I can use I love technology, and I can use the email and I can Google. But if you tell me to program or to set up website, it's just like a lesson to the finance. You know, it's just hopeless. Yeah. So you know, I'm so glad that we have a Jeff. It's just like I always love good food, but I don't know how to cook. Okay, yeah.
I get some comments from I sent out. They said this is beautiful. We did. I said,
thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jeff. And you also can make a comment. And maybe, Jeff, you can tell us if we want to kind of communicate each other or like a material. Can we post the material there?
People can post questions there. And just know if you post it, it'll be viewed by the public. If you want to send something private to Aoife, her email's at the top.
Mm.
But depending on what everyone wants, I can set up a subsection where it's a forum where people can discuss with each other.
Mm.
But something I guess we could discuss next week.
But can I post like a Kamana Sutra there too?
Yeah.
We can put it there, huh?
Yes.
Yeah, so then you can download.
Yeah.
So, you know, there was some material, then you know you can download from there. We kind of put it there. Definitely, you know, like before the weekend. Okay, definitely before the weekend for the material. Yeah. What time is it?
As a reminder, make sure if you haven't already, put your email address in the back there, so then you can send out the information to everyone.
Okay, good. Anyone have any announcement or question or anything else? Yeah.
Well, can you say in Chinese what is that?
The Theravada's tradition.
Okay, so it's
It's not from the Han, 不是从 汉传的.
Okay.
Yeah, 可能有些, it may there are some correspondence, but the Kalama Sutra it's we got it from the Pali that were translated in Pali tradition. It's a part. If I have a chance, I will introduce the scripture, the
so
different tradition.
No,
I think there was some correspondence, but not the whole sutra. Maybe there was some correspondence.
What,
有一些相应的.
Name,
just
name, like
Hostra
is like
清清. 不是，它没有一个完全的 sutra.
Okay.
Oh, okay, yeah.
What is the intranet you said?
Intranet, 就是因陀罗嘛。 因陀罗网, okay. Maybe next time I try to give you some of the kanji as well. Okay. Well, what time now? Oh, we only have 50 minutes. Do you think you'd like to sit for 5 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do that. Could we just move the chair? Okay, and then bring a cushion and sit in a circle. And sorry, leave this one for me.
I want to sit on a chair, please.